Cynthia Marshall is very proud of her school and her upbringing. She's been a very busy woman the past many years. I want to introduce her tonight. She's the president of AT&T North Carolina and directly responsible for the company's regulatory, legislative, and community affairs activities in the state while overseeing AT&T's operations of 7,500 employees. I bet that's a pain at times, taking care of all those people. She's a self-professed sports nut and soccer mom. She has a passion for her work, and by her resume, you can tell it. Enjoys being busy, loves working for AT&T, a graduate of the University of California at Berkeley, blue and gold, and was on the cheerleading team. If you coax her, maybe she'll get a cheer in tonight. Ladies and gentlemen, I present tonight keynote speaker, Miss Cynthia G. Marshall, everybody.
That's my favorite song. And that version is my favorite version, the Michael McDonald version. So we probably grew up around the same time, huh? Mm-hmm, I know it. How's everybody? Y'all having a good time? Isn't this awesome? Come on, you can clap. This is awesome. I am so happy to be here. Thank you so much. My friend Jennifer Bryan, you know I love you. I absolutely love you. We have been trying to do this for a while, so I finally made it. I am here, and so I want to give it up for Jennifer and Joe Bryan. You know I love you too. Oh, I love you both. And then I want to acknowledge Herb Crenshaw and the folks at the AT&T table. Where are you, AT&T? Stand up, AT&T. Give AT&T their props now. Woo, woo, woo. Now, it has been a very exciting week for us. I don't know if you saw some of the headlines. We were in Kings Mountain yesterday. Now, up until yesterday, I have to admit, I didn't know where Kings Mountain was. But I know now where it is. And yesterday, we announced what is supposedly the biggest thing that's happened in terms of investment in Cleveland County. And we announced yesterday a 14-year project where we're opening up a big enterprise data center that ultimately will have over $1 billion impact to the community, a few hundred jobs, investment, et cetera. So I am excited about what we are doing in this state. So I am proud to be an AT&T employee, and more importantly, I am proud to be a North Carolinian. I was blessed to get a call December of 2000, and I guess it was 2006. And so January 2007, 5 years ago, we moved here from the San Francisco Bay Area. And I will tell you, you have made this California girl a North Carolinian. And so I've learned a few things. I've learned just a few things in the past 5 years. Now, my parents were born in Birmingham, Alabama, which actually they're from there, and I was actually born in Birmingham, but they left there when I was 3 months old. But I have learned a few things since I've been here. I have learned, first of all, that my mother was right. All those years she said it was a pocketbook and not a purse. Apparently she was right, okay? It is a pocketbook. All those years that she said, bless your heart, I have realized it was not really a blessing. And truly I have learned that North Carolinians are truly the nicest people on the planet. So thank you for welcoming me and my family. We are proud North Carolinians. Now, I have about 15, 20 minutes here, so let me just give you the ground rules for the next few minutes. I only have three of them. The first one is that you have to get comfortable with the people at your table. So look and see who's at the table, smile at them. I know you guys are eating. Tell them you're just glad to see them. Reach out and touch them, okay? Okay, now the second ground rule. Okay, not too much now, not too much. The second ground rule is that you have to let me know you're out there. So I like interaction, so every now and then you can give me an amen, tell it like it is, okay? All right, sister, you have to talk to me because I'm pretty loud and I like to have a good time if you haven't figured that out already. Okay, hey, talk to me, brother. And then my third ground rule is that if you have a cell phone, I mean, you can hold up your cell phone. It doesn't have to be, if you have a cell phone, I love AT&T. Okay? If you have I tell people I am AT&T. I'm anointed to testify. Now, if you have a cell phone, you do not have to turn it off. You can turn it on, you can text, you can talk, and you don't even have to step out. You know why? Because that is how I make my money, and that is how my kids eat. So every time I hear when they say turn off the phones, I'm like, that ain't working for me. I like to hear, in fact, the phone went off right after the invocation. I said, thank you, Jesus. I like that. I like that. Okay, so remember ground rule number one, okay? So look at your neighbor. Now, let me warn you right now, I grew up in a Pentecostal church. Now, don't y'all worry about, we're going to get out before midnight, okay? But I like to have a good time. So look at your neighbor and say, neighbor. No, I said I grew up in a Pentecostal church. I got to get loud. Neighbor.
Neighbor.
The person we see
is the person we will be.
Okay, let me tell you a story. A legend tells of a prince who suffered from a spinal problem. He could only walk with his back arched and his face looking down. This caused him great physical pain and emotional despair. Finally, he went to a great sculptor and asked him to carve a statue that would portray him without a spinal deformity. Working rapidly, the sculptor soon created a magnificent likeness of the prince, tall and straight. Shall I place it in front of the palace gate for all to see? Asked the sculptor. No, answered the prince. I want it placed in my private garden, where only I can see it. Once the statue was in place, the prince spent part of each day observing it, dreaming of the man he might have been if his back were straight. As time passed, people in his kingdom noticed a change in the prince. He was standing a little taller and straighter. A physical change was definitely taking place. As the prince visualized himself with a straight back, he began to rise up to the image in his mind. I grew up as the fourth child of six in the Easter Hill housing projects in Richmond, California. When I was 11 years old, a tragic incident occurred in our family, and I witnessed my father shoot a man in the head in self-defense. Actually, probably more in defense of me, since I was standing on my father's side when it happened, watching the entire situation unfold. You see, I was supposed to be in the back room with my five brothers and sisters, but in my usual nosy fashion, I wanted to see what was going on. I wanted to see what the commotion at the front door was all about. My father did not realize that I was standing at his side until the young man pulled out a silver pistol and pointed it down to my father's right side. That's when my father looked down, and he knew that I was not in the back room with my mother and my brothers and sisters, but in the potential pathway of a bullet. Everyone in our family coped differently with this situation. I found my refuge in the classroom and in my books. The classroom was a place where I could hide, feel free, and feel safe. So when we were all supposed to be sequestered in the house for safety purposes, I insisted on going to school. And I was blessed that I had a mother who allowed that. As a seventh grader, I had to be escorted to school each day by a uniformed police officer. Despite me finding refuge in the classroom and feeling safe at school, the family situation was still bad with lots of violence and turmoil, a typical inner city housing project. And my parents divorced 4 years later when I was 15 years old. In an ugly rage, before my junior year in high school, my father left us. Although he left us with very little, which was one full-size mattress in a four-bedroom housing project unit, he left me with something very profound, the image of what I would become. The image was this. He said I would be stuck in the projects with no way out, smart but to what end, pregnant by 16 and on drugs by 18, like many in my neighborhood. To be specific, hookers on the street was the destiny that he predicted for me and my youngest sister. Now, in an instant, as I heard these words, I flashed back not to the rocky childhood, not to the abusive home life, not to the bad neighborhood, but to the foundation of love and faith that was provided by my mother. My mother, who taught me it's not where you live, it's how you live. And a mother who also taught me that you can do anything if you put your mind to it and trust in the Lord. Anybody had a mother like that who told you you could do anything? So in response to my father, I spoke the following words to my sister. Now notice I said I spoke them to my sister because I grew up in a time when you couldn't talk back to your parents. In fact, my kids are still growing up at a time when you can't talk back to your parents. I don't blame that. I told my sister, I said, we will be the first to graduate from college. We will get our mother out of the projects, and I will be the president of something one day. I saw a Cynthia that was different from the one that my father saw. Look at your neighbor again and say, the person you see is the person you will be. Now I want you to, in the church, we look at the other neighbor. We always had two, okay? So look at your other neighbor and say, neighbor,
now is the time
to rethink possible. I had a mental picture before me, and I was determined to grow into that image. I spent the next 2 years in high school very focused, graduated the top of my school district, and was offered a full scholarship to the college of my choice, the University of California at Berkeley. Now in college, I continued that same level of focus that I had in high school. In fact, this is how focused I was. In my first year of college, actually it was my first week of college, my boyfriend called me and said he had changed colleges and he was in San Francisco so that he could be close to me. He said, surprise, I've moved. I'm right across the bay. And I said, hold up, boyfriend. I said, I got a surprise for you. I said, I'll call you the day I graduate. Now, this is my first year in college. I said, honey, I don't have time for some smooth-talking cutie he wants to play when I need to study. I'm on a mission. I got to get my mother out of projects. I will call you the day I graduate. So 4 years later, I called that boy. I said, hey, this is Sin. He said, Sin who? I said, now, don't act like you don't know me. Didn't I tell you I was going to call you the day I graduated? He said, I haven't talked to you in 4 years. I said, well, honey, I just graduated. I'm going to start working for the phone company. I got to take 3 weeks off to watch my soap operas. My mother's having me a party at 6. She's still in the projects, but I'm going to get her out. I said, you be there at 6 o'clock. He said, I can't be there. I'm engaged. I said, hold on, boyfriend. I told you I was calling you the day I graduated. So I'm happy to say he came to the party, and we're getting ready to celebrate 29 years of marriage. I always say, boy, you almost missed your blessing. So here I am, by the grace of God, standing before you as the highest ranking African-American woman and an officer of the nation's largest telecommunications corporation, AT&T. And now, after having worked 30 years in a male-dominated industry, after having prayed my way through many trials and tribulations, both personally and professionally, after having been blessed enough to make it out of poverty and to break down many barriers and put many cracks in the glass ceiling, I tell people that I am AT&T. I am anointed to testify. Look at somebody and say, AT&T, anointed to testify. That's me. So let me testify to you of just a few of the many things that I have learned as I have been on this amazing journey from the projects to the president's office. And I hope you will be able to use these lessons as you pursue your business adventures and your community service. I've learned 6 key lessons. First of all, to always remember where you came from, or you might forget where you are going. And don't just look back, but give back to your family, your community, and your neighbors. The scripture says, and this is what I try to live by, to whom much is given, much is required. The second thing I've learned is to do the right thing. There is a difference between doing things right and doing the right thing. Never compromise your integrity. I have learned, you can clap, that's right, never compromise your integrity. I have learned the importance of knowing why I'm doing what I'm doing, the real reason for it. Why is sometimes more important than how. I heard someone say one time, the person who knows how will always have a job. The person who knows why will always be his boss. Knowing why will help you do things from the heart, not just the mind. And I've also learned, number 4, is sometimes the light at the end of the tunnel is a train. Bad things do happen to good people. Accept adversity and make a vow to never give up. From 1993 to 1996, I have what I called a bad season that I thought I'd never recover from. I lost one of my jobs, and in my first executive job in the company, I buried a daughter at 6.5 months old after having 4 second trimester miscarriages, and finally we were able to have a child, and we had to bury that baby at 6.5 months old. And then a few months after that, my husband got brain damage, and they said he would never walk and talk again. But I learned that tough times don't last, but tough people do. He is walking and talking by the grace of God. And what I learned through all that is the importance of keeping your perspective. And my daughter taught me a very valuable lesson when she was 12 years old. I remember getting a call at work, and she said, "Mommy, I am so excited." She says, "We just left the eye doctor, and the doctor says I'm blind as a bat." She says, "Now I have to wear glasses like you. Hurry up and get home." She was so excited. So I got home and she had 4 pairs of glasses. I don't know what got into my husband. She had soccer glasses, soccer goggles, swim goggles, 12 years old, okay? Sunglasses and regular glasses. And she wanted me to try her eyeglasses on. I tried on her glasses and I could see perfectly through her glasses. And she could see my whole countenance change. And I said, "Honey," she says, "Mommy, why are you so sad?" And I just looked at her. I said, "Honey, I didn't know your vision was so poor." I said, "Honey, you have 47-year-old eyes. I mean, I could see perfectly." She looked at me and she says, "I don't know what's wrong with you, young thing. You ought to be happy. You got 12-year-old eyes." So that was my lesson. So I look at life now through 12-year-old eyes. The fifth thing I've learned is that people matter, and that's all that matters. It is all about people. Look around this room right now. Just look at these people. You know some of these people, some of them you don't know, but I will tell you what, you need these people. You need to rely on them because we need each other. I'm going to ask you to stand up for a minute. And I'm almost done. I'm feeling it now. Hallelujah. I'm going to ask you to go find 3 people. See, this is how we do at church, okay? Y'all ain't going to invite me to come back, but that's all right. Find 3 people, because sometimes we just don't take the time to let people know that they matter to us, that they're important, and that we love them, and that we can count on each other. There's a lot of stuff going on in this world right now. We need to know that we can count on each other. So I want you to just go and find 3 people, let them know you love them, and they can count on you. Give me some music, Carlton. I'll talk about. I have learned the importance of finding your passion and your purpose and to get busy making a difference for someone else. Martin Luther King Jr. said, "Life's most persistent and urgent question is what have you done for others?" So if you would allow me as I close, I would like to share my passion with you. So I'd like to have you close your eyes. Don't go to sleep. Close your eyes and picture a rundown, abandoned hotel. In one of the abandoned rooms, picture a baby boy born in the bathtub. He is now 9 months old, lying on the floor, hardly clothed, with his 9-year-old brother taking care of him. Imagine the feelings of the 9-year-old as he looks out of a dirty window and sees his mother being taken away by 2 police officers. Now move your eyes around this empty hotel room with the 9-year-old as he is searching for food for himself and his infant brother. Take a look at the small toaster oven that is being used to keep the 9-month-old baby boy warm. Picture the 9-year-old serving as the sole caretaker for 2 months until someone finally tells the police that Mary left 2 boys in the room of the abandoned hotel. Picture the frail condition of the screaming 9-month-old, who is now 11 months old, and the despair, relief, and sadness on the face of the 9-year-old when they are finally rescued. Open your eyes. Can you feel the pain of that 9-month-old and that 9-year-old? Close your eyes again. Picture a little girl who is less than 1 day old and weighs less than 2 pounds, lying in a hospital with her mother nowhere in sight. Imagine a woman giving birth and walking out of the hospital that same day, leaving her premature and very sick daughter. Picture her marching toward the front door, never looking back and never to return for her baby. Picture her running out to continue her cocaine habit. Picture the baby girl being cared for and named by her nurses with no mother or family to be found. They named her Small Isha, small because she was premature, Isha because she was black. Picture this baby girl now 2 years old in the temporary care of foster parents, nursed to somewhat decent health, but still with lots of medical issues, and worse yet, nowhere to go. Open your eyes. Now those are sad, pitiful stories. But let me give you the happy ending to that those tragic stories. Those children were adopted, and the 9-month-old boy, when he was 5 years old, after he was adopted, he saw the little girl who was 2 on TV. She was on the news. They were trying to find a home for her. And he convinced his father to call this 100 kind of number because he said that little girl needed a big brother, nothing about a mama or a daddy, but that she needed a big brother because she needed to be adopted the way he had been adopted so that she could be happy. Fortunately, my husband and I are the parents of those 2 children. And when we moved here to North Carolina, my son was watching TV again and heard something about what was going on in the foster care system. So 2 years ago, we adopted a 12-year-old, so now we have a 14-year-old. In fact, when we moved my son to college, he's a sophomore now at High Point University. So all the things that the social worker said about he'd never be normal and all this stuff, the boy is a star, all my kids are stars. When we moved him to college, I said, give me the remote control. Because no more television, honey. Every time you get busy, I end up with another kid in the house. But we have 3 wonderful children. That is my passion. My passion is permanence and stability for our children. So my charge to all of you tonight, as a chamber and as individuals, as you embark upon another year, I'm asking you to do something special. And that is take up a cause that is bigger than you and not about you. I'm asking you to carry out a renewed purpose in your life. I call it getting mad, M-A-D, making a difference. There are so many people out there that need us. My passion is our children. I don't know what your passion is. I said we get busy about our passions. I have a gift for you at the table. There's a bag. There should be an AT&T bag. And if somebody could grab that bag and pass out the gift, I'm going to leave you. I have 2 gifts. I have one for you. And then I have one for Jennifer and the chamber. Now inside that, there is a flashlight. Now it just so happens to be an AT&T flashlight. I just couldn't help myself. I had to have the globe on it. And it is a light to encourage you to go out into your neighborhoods, into your communities, and to others' communities, and shed some light on some of the awful situations that are happening and unfolding in our neighborhoods. The situation that I described with my children, even though they are 17 and 19 and a half now, those situations are still unfolding every day in our communities. Go out and shed a light on the situation and let somebody know the way people let me know to rethink possible, that there is a great life out there and we can be a part of it. Now, is Herb Crenshaw in the room? Did he leave? Okay, Jennifer, I'd like for you to come up as I close. I'd like to give you a gift. Now, some people don't know this, but I actually got into a bidding war one time with the Carolina basketball. Okay, this whole Carolina thing, you know, I'm used to the Berkeley Stanford thing. I think this Carolina Duke thing is kind of out of hand, but. But we ended up donating the ball. Well, I had the pleasure of chairing, being the honorary chair for the Cornucopia Cancer Center's annual fundraiser on February the 12th, called a chocolate affair. And there were two items that my husband bid on. One, he actually bid on lunch with me. He said that was the only way it was going to happen. It cost the boy $2,000. He actually got in a bidding war with this other man, and the man was kind of cute. So I said, I have lunch with both of them. So they got $4,000. They got $4,000 off of lunch with me. And then my husband also, we ended up somehow, we were, you know, Joe, how I am. Some man wanted the basketball so bad, and we outbid him. And so that basketball cost me $2,700, but apparently, somebody named Tyler Hansbrough, Psycho T, or somebody signed the ball. So the marshals are donating that to the chamber tonight. God bless you. Oh, and there are also two tickets to a game for February the 29th and a parking pass. So that's our donation to the chamber. God bless you. Thank you.